All right, so continuing on with Beatty's analysis, just a couple more things to point out before we move on fairly quickly to the end of this section and then go on to part two, the sieve in the sand. So, interestingly, we left off with the minorities being appeased, people not wanting to have conflict. And the fear or dread of being inferior to others and stigmatizing intellectuals, and it was like a fear-based reaction. We saw that the dystopia is actually a worldwide dystopia, interestingly, and we want to all kind of remember in the background is this sort of threat of atomic bomb. That was supposed to be a bomb, but my artwork didn't work out there. So the atomic bomb and war is kind of in the background here. And who's at war? Well, it seems like there's some rebel group that doesn't want the existing society and probably want to preserve books and knowledge and history and so on. So the door opened to the parlor, and Mildred stood there looking at them, looking at Beatty and then at Montag. Behind her, the walls of the room were flooded with green and yellow and orange fireworks, sizzling and bursting to some music composed almost completely of trap drums, tom-toms, and cymbals. Her mouth moved, and she was saying something, but the sound covered it. Okay, this is a very interesting description of Mildred's powerlessness. And she is overshadowed by the technology, really, the lights and the sound. You can't hear what she's saying. She's speaking, but she's blocked by the crazy, loud and empty media that she's consuming. Beatty knocked his pipe into the palm of his pink hand, studied the ashes as if they were a symbol to be diagnosed and searched for meaning. You must understand that our civilization is so vast that we can't have our minorities upset and stirred. Ask yourself, what do we want in this country above all? People want to be happy. Isn't that right? Haven't you heard it all your life? I want to be happy, people say. Well, aren't they? Don't we keep them moving? Don't we give them fun? That's all we live for, isn't it? For pleasure, for titillation. And you must admit, our culture provides plenty of these. Yes. Montag could lip read what Mildred was saying in the doorway. He tried not to look at her mouth because then Beatty might turn and read what was there too. Colored people don't like little black Sambo. Burn it. White people don't feel good about Uncle Tom's Cabin. Burn it. Someone's written a book on tobacco and cancer of the lungs. The cigarette people are weeping. Burn the book. Serenity, Montag. Peace, Montag. Take your fight outside, better yet, into the incinerator. Funerals are unhappy and pagan. Eliminate them too. 5 minutes after a person is dead, he's on his way to the big flue, the incinerator service by helicopters all over the country. 10 minutes after death, a man's a speck of black dust. Let's not quibble over individuals with memoriams. Forget them. Burn them all. Burn everything. Fire is bright and fire is clean. Now we see other social customs and traditions have been overwritten in this dystopian worldview. Even to the point of something as traditional as funeral services. Well, why is that? Well, if they just want to have fun in this society, they do not want to contemplate. There's no contemplation of deeper realities. Things like our soul, heaven and hell, etc. So nothing beyond the material realm, beyond materialism, what you can touch and feel and sensations. They don't want to think deeper than that. So, and they don't want any unhappy, bad feelings. So what's the custom in this future world? There's no funeral service. You just take the body to this big, huge kind of chimney, like a flue, and there are incinerators, things that burn stuff there. Helicopters just drop the bodies in there, and 10 minutes later, they're all burned up. You don't have to think about it. The fireworks died in the parlor behind Mildred. She had stopped talking at the same time. A miraculous coincidence. Montag held his breath. There was a girl next door, he said slowly. She's gone now, I think. Dead. I can't even remember her face, but she was different. How? How did she happen? So, now Montag is asking about Clarice. So, he's not directly asking what happened to her, where is Clarice, but how do what we would call non-conformist people originate in this society? If everyone is brainwashed with the same thing, then somebody, and if everyone's happy, then why would anybody go against the norm? Why would anybody be a rebel? Like, he's saying, how did she happen? How did people who don't agree with the system arrive in the system, or appear in the system, or develop in the system? Beatty smiled. Here or there, that's bound to occur. Clarice McClellan, we've a record on her family. We've watched them carefully. Heredity and environment are funny things. You can't rid yourself of all the odd ducks in just a few years. The home environment can undo a lot you try to do at school. That's why we've lowered the kindergarten age year after year until now we're almost snatching them from the cradle. We've had some false alarms on the McClellan when they lived in Chicago. Never found a book. Uncle had a mixed record, antisocial. The girl, she was a time bomb. The family had been feeding her subconscious, I'm sure, from what I saw of her high school record. She didn't want to know how a thing was done, but why. Okay. What's going on there? She's asking critical thinking questions like why, which means reasoning. If you think of the word reasoning, reason, to give a reason for something, is to answer why. That's what she's asking. Why are we doing this? Why are things this way? It's not a much practical for how. If you only care about how, that's called pragmatism. Is it functional? Is it going to get you some result? You know, get your university degree so you can get a job so you can make money. Nothing deeper than that. But Clarice was asking deeper questions than that. That can be embarrassing. You ask why to a lot of things, and you wind up very unhappy indeed if you keep at it. The poor girl's better off dead. Yes, dead. Luckily, queer ones like her don't happen often. This means strange or different. So don't give it the modern meaning of that word. That's not what that word meant originally. It had nothing to do with sexual orientation. It just means different, strange. We know how to nip most of them in the bud early. You can't build a house without nails and wood. If you don't want a house built, hide the nails and the wood. If you don't want a man unhappy politically, don't give him two sides to a question to worry him. Give him one. Better yet, give him none. Let him forget there's such a thing as war. If the government is inefficient, top-heavy, and tax-mad, better it be all those than that people worry over it. peace, Montag. Give the people contests they win by remembering the words to more popular songs or the names of state capitals or how much corn Iowa grew last year. Cram them full of non-combustible data. Chalk them so damn full of facts they feel stuffed, but absolutely brilliant with information. Then they'll feel their thinking, they'll get a sense of motion without moving, and they'll be happy because facts of that sort don't change. Don't give them any slippery stuff like philosophy or sociology to tie things up with. That way lies melancholy. Any man who can take a TV wall apart and put it back together again, and most men can nowadays, is happier than any man who tries to slide rule measure and equate the universe, which just won't be measured or equated without making man feel bestial and lonely. I know, I've tried it. To hell with it. So bring on your clubs and parties, your acrobats and magicians, your daredevils, jet cars, motorcycle helicopters, your sex and heroin, more of everything to do with automatic reflex. If drama is bad, if the film says nothing, if the play is hollow, sting me with the theremin loudly. I think I'm responding to the play when it's only a tactile reaction to vibration. But I don't care. I just like solid entertainment. And there you have a summary of the philosophy of hedonism. And what's that? Hedonism is this seeking pleasure. That's it. That's the point of life, supposedly, according to hedonism. Just seek pleasure. Eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow we die. And this leads to total emptiness. Totally pointless and empty soul. So, Beatty isn't saying that's what he believes, but he's describing the philosophy that led to this society. Beatty is more complex than this, but this is what the general populace believe. Okay? So this whole section is extremely important because we get the true background. Now, I just want to... Beatty leaves just shortly after that. He gets going. Montag gets to stay home. After Beatty leaves, Montag brings out the books and tries to read with Mildred, tries to reason with her. But she doesn't want really anything to do with it. And I want to just point out something quickly on page 65, toward the end of this section. They're opening a book and trying to figure out how to read a book. But the problem is they don't know how to think because they've grown up in this crazy society and been oversimplified and brainwashed. So when he finally actually gets the books from the ventilator, he opens a single small volume and he says, "Where do we begin?" He doesn't really even know how to read a book, let alone understand a book, let alone how to find information and digest it. He opened the book halfway and peered at it. "We begin at the beginning, I guess." "He'll come in," said Mildred, "and burn us and the books." So notice Mildred's response is fear-based still. She's so brainwashed that she has this dread, the conditioning. Fear was also the basis for hating intellectuals. Front door voice faded. At last there was a silence. Montag felt the presence of someone beyond the door, waiting, listening. Then the footsteps going away, down the walk, and over the lawn. Was it the hound? Maybe. They don't know who was at the front door. "Let's see what this is," said Montag. He spoke the words haltingly and with a terrible self-consciousness. He read a dozen pages here and there and came at last to this. "It is computed that 11,000 persons have at several times suffered death rather than submit to break eggs at the smaller end." Mildred sat across the hall from him. "What does it mean?" "Doesn't mean anything. The captain was right." "Here now," said Montag. "We'll start over again at the beginning." So they can't interpret or understand. They don't know how to use the information.